The U.S. criminal justice system has been heavily shaped by debates on the determinants of criminal behavior. In the 1960s, one prominent perspective emphasized the role of mental illness and argued for more therapeutic approaches, but another argued that offenders weigh the costs and benefits of engaging in crime and can be deterred from committing offenses if the cost is high enough. This view spurred a wave of policies in the following decades that increased the severity of punishments and contributed to rapid growth in the incarcerated population. Today, the economic and social costs of that system have come increasingly under scrutiny, and policymakers have been forced to consider alternative policies for criminal deterrence. Against that backdrop, this paper revisits the role of mental health care in reducing criminal behavior. Individuals with mental illness are significantly overrepresented in prisons and jails, and in this paper's data, low-income men with a mental health history are almost 3 times more likely to have been incarcerated by age 24 than men without a mental health history. This raises the question, can improved access to mental health care reduce criminal involvement? To investigate this, the author uses administrative data for a sample of low-income male adolescents in South Carolina and studies how losing Medicaid coverage affects their likelihood of incarceration. Medicaid provides free health coverage to those with limited resources and is the largest provider of mental health care in the U.S. But while the South Carolina program covers low-income children, it does not extend to childless adults. Individuals who are enrolled in Medicaid throughout adolescence age out of eligibility on their 19th birthday. The author estimates the effect of this lapse in coverage by comparing the trajectories of 2 groups. First are men who were likely to be enrolled in Medicaid before their 19th birthdays and who were therefore affected by the sudden termination in eligibility. These individuals are matched using demographic characteristics, geographic location, and mental health histories, to an observationally similar group of low-income men who were enrolled in Medicaid earlier in their adolescence, but who for idiosyncratic reasons were less likely to be enrolled prior to their 19th birthdays, and who were therefore less affected by the loss in eligibility. To illustrate, this figure shows the trajectory of Medicaid enrollment for each group. High enrollment men experience a large decline in enrollment after their 19th birthdays, while low enrollment men are significantly less affected by the loss of eligibility. The idea is that this group acts as a comparison and aids in tracing out the counterfactual path of high enrollment men had they not lost access to Medicaid at this precise point. And the results show a striking pattern. This figure plots the likelihood of incarceration for high and low enrollment men. For a full 1.5 years prior to their 19th birthdays, both groups have extremely similar trajectories, but a divergence occurs precisely when the high enrollment group loses access to Medicaid. After their 19th birthdays, high enrollment men are 14% more likely to be incarcerated in any given quarter relative to low enrollment men. Looking at differences in the likelihood of ever having been incarcerated shows that the increase in incarceration rates is driven by new individuals having their first serious contact with the criminal justice system. By their 20th birthdays, men in the high enrollment group who lost access to Medicaid are 11% more likely to have been incarcerated than low enrollment men, and this rises to 16% by their 21st birthdays. Crucially, these patterns appear to be driven by the loss of mental rather than physical health care. These figures split the sample by men's mental health histories and show that the estimated effects are entirely driven by men with mental illness. This suggests that there is a population of low-income young men, specifically those with mental health histories, for whom access to mental health care plays an important role in shaping their criminal trajectory. Once they lose access to health services, they are more likely to commit an offense and become incarcerated for the first time. Consistent with this, when the sample is split according to how recently individuals were filing mental health claims, we see that the effects of losing Medicaid are larger for those who were using behavioral health services right before aging out of eligibility. These results indicate that providing low-income young men with access to mental health care would decrease their criminal involvement, but is this a cost-effective way to reduce crime? Two analyses suggest the answer is yes. First, a back-of-the-envelope calculation combining this paper's findings with existing estimates for the social and fiscal costs of incarceration and crime shows that in this sample, the benefits of providing low-income young men with Medicaid eligibility outweigh the costs of doing so. Second, a benchmarking exercise shows that if the goal is to deter young adults from engaging in crime, Medicaid is significantly more cost-effective than longer punishments, which has been a favored approach for reducing crime for the past half century. Low-income adolescents in this sample are relatively undeterred by harsher criminal sanctions, so it is nearly twice as costly to try to reduce crime through longer sentences than through providing Medicaid eligibility. Altogether, these findings suggest that in the ongoing discussion around criminal justice reform, policymakers might wish to consider improved access to healthcare as one approach for reducing crime and decreasing expenditures. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes research on mental health and criminal activity, crime deterrence, and the social returns to Medicaid.